Thank you everyone for coming, and I would like to welcome you to the panel discussion on entrepreneurship in Indonesia, hosted by Fermias Massachusetts. My name is Panji Haji Sumarto, and I will moderate this discussion for you today. It's a great honor for me to be here alongside with three entrepreneurs, young entrepreneurs from Indonesia. And first of all, I would like to thank you to be here, and then I'd like to thank AIS, Association of Indonesian Students at MIT, for reserving the room for us. And then, we will invite everyone to come and sit. So this is what we're going to have today. So we will start with all of the entrepreneurs presenting their projects and their businesses in Indonesia for about 10 minutes, and then we will have a very short question and answer session regarding their presentations. And for the second session, we will have a panel discussion where you can ask questions, and then I will moderate the discussion for you. So, but first of all, let me introduce you to our three speakers here. So next to me, we have Azalea Ayu Ningtyas. Ayu, for sure. She's the co-founder. She did her undergrad study in molecular biology in University of Michigan. She did her Master of Public Health in Harvard School of Public Health. And now she's full-time entrepreneur at Duanyam. And then next we have Adamas Belfasyah Devara. I need to read that. So, in short, Belva. He is a co-founder of Ruang Guru, or is it ruangguru.com?
Both.
So Ruang Guru. So, I forgot to introduce what Duanyam is. Let me start back with Duanyam. So Duanyam, what IU has is a social enterprise that provides pregnant women with alternative employment to subsistence farming. So this is based in Nusa Tenggara Timur, in East Nusa Tenggara. The idea is to reduce exposure to prenatal risk associated with heavy labor. So what Belva has is Ruang Guru, which is a website that connects prospective students to find qualified teachers from different backgrounds of study. You can find any kind of teacher there, from math for elementary students to yo-yo teacher, or Bahasa Sunda if you want to learn Bahasa Sunda. So Belva did his undergrad studies in business and computer science at Nanyang Technology University in Singapore. And he's now a full-time student doing MBA, MPA at Stanford and Harvard. And last but not least, we have Horlicks Leo, co-founder of Cold Press Indonesia. So Cold Press sells natural cold press juice. And we'll hear more about what Cold Press is from Horlicks. So cold press sells all natural cold press juice that comes without added sugar, preservatives and additives. So Horlicks did his undergrad studies in engineering and commerce in University of New South Wales, Australia, and now he's a full-time student at Babson doing his MBA. Alright, so without further ado, we'll start with Ayu with her presentation on Duanyam. So Ayu, you will have 10 minutes, about 10 minutes for your presentation.
Yeah.
Thank you,
Mas Pandi. Great, so good morning everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to be here as a speaker alongside Belva and Horlicks, two inspiring and perhaps more experienced entrepreneurs than me. So I graduated from Harvard School of Public Health last year, as Mas Pandi said. Worked for a year in a strategy consulting firm in Boston, and I am the co-founder and CEO of Duanyam. Now, Duanyam is a social enterprise that provides alternative employment for pregnant women in NTT. We aim to improve maternal and newborn health by reducing the risk of heavy labor during pregnancy, and we do this by leveraging existing skills in the community, which is women. So before I go into much detail about Duanyam, I want to share a little bit briefly, like how I get where I am now, and also talk about social enterprise. So as Ms. Panji said, I graduated from undergraduate program in molecular biology where I did a lot of lab work. And I love the subject, but I realized that I want to do something where I can see the impact more immediately, right? So I did my master in public health. And research and work in public health involve more human interaction, and the impact is also more immediate. However, one day when I was in the slum of India doing research, there was one old lady. She suddenly come in and she interrupted my interview, and she shouted, "Get out of my house! Like, you people come and go asking all these questions, doing your study, but nothing in my life has ever changed." So that's when I suddenly realized that to satisfy my personal passion, I need to do something where I can see more immediate impact in public health research. That's around the time when I discovered social enterprise. I was selected to be participate in Project Antares. It's a collaboration with the School of Public Health and Harvard Business School. We went to Cambodia and we consulted a social enterprise that sells toilets to poor people in rural area. And this project really thrilled me because I thought to myself, wow, this is something where I can combine my public health knowledge with my family business background, and I can see immediate impact of what I do in the community I work in. So that's when I know social enterprise is a career for me. So what defines social enterprise? As you can see here, maybe in the spectrum, there are traditional nonprofits that depends on donor funding to deliver social goods. And then on the other hand, there are traditional business that sells products and services and needs to be profitable. Social enterprise is a hybrid between the two. So it has the nonprofit's social mission, but it also has the financial objective of traditional business. Basically, it needs to be financially sustainable to be able to achieve its social goals. Right, so just briefly, here are some social enterprise examples, and I just want to illustrate how the different business models works in these examples. So first we have Grameen Bank. It's founded by Muhammad Yunus, Nobel Prize winner, and basically it's a for-profit microfinance that serves poor people who would otherwise have no access to financial service. And then Grameen also collaborate with Danone, Grameen Danone, and they sell highly nutritious yogurt for poor and undernourished children. And of course we all know Palms with its famous one-for-one model where you buy one shoes, then they will donate one shoes to poor people in developing countries. And this subsidy type model is also we can see in Arafin eye care system. That's basically they perform eye surgery 70% for poor people at free or below cost, and 30% for people who can pay and afford high premium cost, all with the same quality of service. So there are a lot of other social enterprises all trying to use different innovation to solve a lot of social problems. But for us, the problem is high rate of maternal and newborn mortality in NDP. So the project starts as a class project for me. I was taking the class in School of Public Health, Social Entrepreneurship in Health and Environment. And I was brainstorming with a friend of mine. She works in NTT for an agricultural NGO. And we found out that in 2013 alone, there were over 250 maternal deaths and 1,300 newborn deaths and 5,000 babies born with low birth weight. And so we're trying to figure out why this is the case. We know that the government and the NGO has been doing group work and trying to improve the supply side, which is the health provider side. So they do this by strengthening the healthcare system and they train doctors and midwives. So why is it that the mortality is too high? Turns out the problem is with the demand side or the mothers or family side, right? So we know that 95% of people in NTT, they work in agriculture. Now this leads to two potential problems for the maternal health and newborn health. So firstly, because the pregnant mother are still working in the field late to their pregnancy, they say, quoted, "until the day I feel the baby is coming." And this is a risk factor for chronic energy deficiency, which we see is highly prevalent among the pregnant mother there. And this could lead to maternal and infant complications. So the second problem, because agriculture is a source of income that is not continuous throughout the year, and it's also sometimes not enough, to cover the cost that is associated with delivering in health clinics, a lot of the women try to kind of like postpone going to the health clinics to deliver, and sometimes it can be too late. So this is just to illustrate the fields. It's not like a farm field, like rice fields. It's up in the hill and about like 1 to 2 kilometers away from their home, and when they're pregnant, they still go towards there. So we're thinking alternative employment can be a solution to this. And we know that a lot of women can leave using Palmyra leave, but there is no market currently for it. So here's what we want to do. We want to leverage on the existing skills in the community, and we want to tackle the solution through 3 steps, right? So the step one is production in weaving or farming co-op. So currently it's already existing in the community that women likes to work together. It's kind of like Arisan concept. So if there's 4 women, right? Mrs. A, Mrs. B, C, and D. In day one, A, B, C, D works in A field. Day two, A, B, C, D works in B field, and so on. It's rotating. We propose to add another component, which is weaving. So they still work in rotating fashion, but in their free time, they would also weave, which can be another source of income. Now, what happens when there is pregnancy? Then let's say Mrs. B is pregnant, right? So Mrs. A, C, and D would still work in A field on day one, A, C, D works in B field in day two, and so on. So B field is still tended, but Mrs. B will only focus solely on weaving. And the profit from B's weaving will be distributed accordingly among A, B, C, and D. So other than this model, we would also provide, Duanyam would also provide product design that is marketable for the weavers, and also standardize the production process as well as quality. Okay, so step two is market access. We will sell and market our products to both corporate and individual customer, locally, nationally, and internationally. We targeted corporate customer because we want the continuous stream of income from repeated orders, and also because we want to tap into the high volume where we can reach more women. Now the individual customer is also important because this is where we can get high profit margin, and we can use the profit to sustain our social program. The last step is the empowerment step. So firstly, we economically empower the women by significantly increasing their family income. We would also work with local health workers to educate and encourage the women to practice safe maternal behaviors. Now the education combined with the increase in income, this will lead the women to have reduction in heavy labor during pregnancy, increase in seeking prenatal care, and also increase the affordability to deliver in health clinics. So where we are, since last year we work with Global Poverty Initiative. It's a MIT student group, and we were fortunate to be able to win the MIT Ideas Global Challenge earlier this year and get seed funding. With these funds, we were able to host 2 MIT students to NTT over the summer, and we successfully recruit our first weavers group. We conduct market research, we problem solve production issues, we create our product prototypes and create marketing materials. Now we also get sponsorship and seed funding from Unlimited Indonesia, which is a social enterprise incubator that partner with Rockefeller Foundation and British Council. And with their support, we were able to work with the Ministry of Trade and join the exhibition Trade Expo Indonesia. We also create our pricing model, and we secure some demands as well. And lastly, we are about to be incorporated into a PT. So in the near future, what we want is to achieve smooth operations with a standardized quality. This is what we're still working on right now. And we also noticed that the woman will have a sudden increase in income. So we want to make sure we can guide them to spend this income wisely for the benefit of their family. So that's all I have to share today. Thank you again for the opportunity, and looking forward to the questions later.
Thank you. I appreciate the presentation. Excellent presentation. let us just move on to Belfast presentation.
Basically, we are an online marketplace for students and teachers, right? So basically, everybody can sign up to be teachers in any subject. So school subjects, sports, languages, public speaking skills, kung fu, whatever, right? And we actually do have all of those teachers on the site currently, right? And then basically, we will verify their information. So they need to upload their transcript and certificates and all that, and then we rate them. And then basically, students can go on the site, and then they can search for teachers that they wanna learn from, right? And then basically, we will match them online, and then they will meet offline. So that's basically the whole idea about Ruang Guru. So yeah, I think I'll just stand here then. So that's the video introduction. So firstly, why did we start this, right? It's because the market is huge. So looking at the global market, it's 103 billion by 2018. So that's private tutoring market, right? And by nature, in Asia, Asia tends to lead the way, right? Because of cultural reasons. Asians like Chinese, South Koreans, Indonesians, we are all crazy about academics. We are crazy about taking exams. Like there's so many boot camps coming up, like before university entrance examinations and all that. So the market is huge and it's growing. Right, and marketing in Indonesia itself is huge. It's just like it's the sheer number of students, millions of them, like hundreds and thousands of students take the university entrance examination every year, and then it's also growing from 14 billion in 2009 and 42 billion in 2020. And current players are scattered, right? Because like there's so many institutions out there in Indonesia, but they are scattered. There are 15,000 of them serving 1.5 million students in Indonesia, right? So we believe that this is prime for disruption, and that's why we entered this space. And the other reason why we wanted to do this is because we believe that education should not stop in the classroom, so kids can actually still learn all other stuff also outside of classrooms. And also, learning should not stop for adults too. Right? After graduating from university, everybody will still need to learn something. Right? In your 20s, in your 30s, in your 40s, probably you want to learn about negotiation, probably you want to learn about public speaking. Right? So there should be an avenue for everybody to learn anything that they want from anybody. And we felt that there's no such platform in Indonesia currently, and that's why we set this up. And this model has actually worked overseas, so it's not only in Indonesia. So for example, in the US, now it's called Wiser. It's huge. There are like 8,000 students, 75,000 tutors, millions of hours of tutoring already registered. And they actually just raised a lot of funding, and they announced intention to expand internationally. And we believe that they will expand at some point to Asia, at which point that is actually our kind of goal, to actually be part of them, to be acquired. That's like that is like an exit strategy for us in the next few years. So, like Tutor Street, for example, they had 7,000 tutors. They were in the United States, and after 2 years, they were acquired by Wisen. And actually, now Ruang Guru is almost the same size as Tutor Street. Wow. We have 6,000 teachers already signed up all across Indonesia. I'll explain more about that later in the slide. And then also the online delivery model. So this is the face-to-face model. This is the online delivery model that we are also going into in the next few years. Tutor Vista in India, they were just acquired by Pearson for $127 million. So, and as was touched in the video for a bit, we actually have social impact as well embedded in the business. So there's a lot of youth unemployment, right? Like for example, like there's so many music teachers. They actually, like they don't really have the skills to be, you know, in the conventional workplace, but they are actually very, very good at music, right? They can do guitars, whatever, right? And they actually can gain a lot of money from Ruang Guru, and there are a lot of cases of that already too, right? And also like some unique skills. Like for example, there's a teacher, and he is teaching magic trick, right? Like nobody would be able to employ him because of that, but actually through Ruang Guru, he could earn some money. And there's the education one for one charity. So for each hour of Ruang Guru, of lessons through Ruang Guru, we will donate a part of our profit equivalent to 1 day of schooling for elementary children through GAN Kota, or Gerakan Nasional Orang Tua. So that's the social impact. So how did we start? So we just launched in April to 2014, right? We secured funding from East Ventures. It's a few hundred thousand dollars. It's seed funding, but it's not disclosed. And so we launched in April, and now by October, we already have 6,000 teachers registered all over Indonesia in all subjects imaginable. Like there's Kung Fu teacher. and so these are some of the sample portfolio companies by East Venture. So there's Tokopedia, which just raised $100 million, Traveloka and all this. And we hope that someday this Ruang Guru will also be as big as the others. So our main goal, oh my god, our main goal is to be the biggest education player in Indonesia, right? So what we do now is just to start, So we start with private tutoring or student-driven. So basically, student initiate, you know, the transaction. So these are like the, you know, the student and the teacher profiles, the rating and their availability and their experiences. And this is like, you can compare, and this is like, yeah. So basically, this is like the private tutoring part, right? But now we are launching actually this month, teacher-driven. So basically now there is a class gallery, right? So instead of like students actually looking for, you know, teachers, but this is like, okay, these are available classes that students can already sign up for, right? So for example, there's like cooking class, like whatever class, right? And we are partnering with a lot of our organizations, vendors too, so that they provide the content and they will publish it here on our website and we take a presentation of the transaction. And then also we also have an experiment which is called Ruang Guru Lab, because the thing is we want to be the biggest education player in Indonesia, so that's why we need to go into content, right? So we do research, consultation, and projects, so basically on project basis. So now we just won a tender basically to create an e-course material for reproductive health for some reason. So that's what we do as well. So we want to develop our capability in content, basically educational content. So that's the experiment. How do we grow? So earned media, online presence, earned media, we were covered by all these. Media, Yahoo, Infocom, Jawa Post, Metro TV, Tech in Asia, Compass, and all that. And the way we did this, and I think nobody actually knows, is the power of press release. So basically, you actually email everybody. So basically, when we got the seed funding, what we did the first time is we actually compiled like hundreds of emails from media, and then we basically blasted a press release, basically saying that we had the seed funding and all that. And the next day, basically every major media covered us, right? And then we were just featured in Bloomberg Business Week. We were actually just featured live on TV on Berita Satu for 30 minutes, and that same video was aired. That same video was aired, and that was free because this was Sumpah Pemuda Day, and then they were like, okay, I wanted to invite somebody like young entrepreneur, and we were lucky enough to be there. So that's it. Online presence. This is just ads on Facebook, Google AdWords. Can actually talk more about Facebook ads because that is very, very, very effective. But I can probably talk about that later in the panel. And then we have a YouTube channel. So basically, we publish very, very regularly about like our open house, teacher profile, student experience, and all that to engage the community. And then last thing is we actually have an offline intervention too. So this is our office in Jakarta, and we designed it in a way that is fun and it's it's pretty. And we just had like an open house. Basically attended by journalists, by celebrities, by social media influencers. This was just last month, basically. I do this every month. So basically, we invited all of them to come to Ruang Guru and we explained to them what's happening. And they can also network with each other and all that. And we have like social media hashtag. Everybody was tweeting about us and all that. And we will also do this as offline intervention. That's it. That's the thing.
Thank you, guys. Very interesting presentation and very interesting response. I mean, for a person like me who actually started teaching from, you know, private lessons in classical guitar. This is one way that I will expand my influence in classical guitar world. Sign up to Ruang Guru.
Of course. I'll make a video of you.
So next one we have Horlicks. Horlicks finish your
So I'm Horlicks. I'm doing my MBA in Babson right now. My business is nothing technical, and I'm gonna just try to explain what drives this business. Yeah, so I'm just gonna explain how it happens from the beginning. So I used to be really fat. I was one of borderline obese, overweight obese, but that was 106, and I'm now 82. So I mean, I know the feeling of being healthy. Like, you don't know how good healthy is until you reach healthy part. So I really like to, you know, help people, like, anytime, discussion, anything about diets, about exercises. It's just my passion in that field. So this is the downside, all right? If you're fat, this is personal experience talking. If you're fat, you're gonna have, I have no confidence. I always feel tired. You always get lazy. Once you're lazy, you're gonna get fatter. And that is just gonna evolve every single time. You're gonna get fatter and fatter, and you're gonna reach triple digits. I don't know, quadruple digits. I don't know. Hopefully not. So, this is the normal things I eat. I lost 24 kilos in 3 months, which is not recommendable to anyone. That's really unhealthy. I just find the quickest way to do it, which is just eating protein, which is not good. You need your carbs, you need your healthy fats, polyunsaturated, monounsaturated, everything, you need everything. So that's my breakfast, that's my lunch, that's my dinner for 90 days, and you'll lose 24 kilos. But unhealthily, you'll get flabby skin all over. So I research a lot after that because I feel like crap, I feel like shit afterwards. I feel all flabby and things, right? So I research about intermittent fasting, which you guys know, Deddy Corbuzier diet. It's not his diet. It's been out there for Muslims. They have been fasting and they get great benefits out of it. If you go to a Muslim person when they're fasting, they won't ever get sick during that 30 days because your body's doing detox every day. That's amazing. So I've been doing research on Atkins, Paleo, Zone diet. If it fit your macros for all you bodybuilders, I don't know. And I've also tried different exercises like high intensity interval training, supersets, drop sets, whatever. So I went through a lot of research, and then what I found is I like to share my experience. I like to share my joy. And then when I help people, I get the joy when I see them getting healthy. And especially when guys, they're like, hey, Lex, check my back out. I'm like, oh, nice. I'm like, oh, good. It's good. So you get the happiness out of helping people. So the main topic that I was assigned to today is like, what differentiates your firm to other firms? It's actually the passion and the joy I get from helping people. It's a very simple thing, but nothing complicated. So I found this concept last December when I was on a holiday with my family in the West Coast. I was just walking around the Hollywood Avenue, the famous Artist Avenue, and then I just found one juice bar, and there's like 30 people lining up. I was like, what the hell's happening? I just walked up. I line up for 30 minutes. I'm like, this better be worth it. Went up to the front, took it. I'm like, wow, this is cool. I'm like, I mean, cold press, what it does is basically it, so far all the juices that you've been drinking, they use a blade. So when the blade touches the fruits and the veggies, it creates friction. And friction creates heat. So when the heat touches the fruits and the veggies, it destroys the healthy enzymes. Put it simply. Yeah. So, yes. So if you use a normal juicer, in comparison to the cold press juicer, it's going to yield 60% more vitamin A. And then for vitamin C, it's going to yield 42% more. And there's other healthy enzymes associated with cold press. So the tagline is freshly made just for you, natural goodness in a bottle. The vision of me and my sister as the founder and co-founder, we wouldn't sell anything that we wouldn't want to drink. That's the simplest idea. So we're health freaks. And I won't sell you guys what I won't consume myself. So that's the basic idea. So to the market. The target market, there's no right way to segment a market. There's no science behind it, it's an art. So smart people, they slice the market off in creative ways. Like the juice industries nowadays, right? We're thinking of slicing off the top part, the high-end part of the juice industry. So we're thinking which target market is the most suitable one for us. So we're thinking the millennials. Millennials is us, mostly, I think. But it's basically the people that's born within 1980 until the 2000. So why do we actually target the millennials? It's because as millennials, the older generation, they look down on us. Not looking down, but they look up to us for health advices, and they'll feel young, and they'll feel up to trend. And the younger people, they look up to us because they want to feel mature, and they want to feel cool. So that's the millennial that I'm talking about. So the next thing is, how do we actually get to there? How do they like to be reached? So for millennials, I think we all know that we like to be in social media. I mean, I check my phone every 5 minutes, every 10 minutes. I go on Instagram every 3 minutes. So that's checking both press. So we know that social networking and browsing the internet is one of our main thing. So the next thing is like, how do we actually communicate through them effectively through social media? So it's proven that the millennials, which is us, 18 to 34 years old, we actually buy our stuff based on word of mouth. It's based on referrals. If I say something is good, and you, let's say you're my friend, Eric, so you believe me and you'll actually buy the thing because you believe what I say. So that's the age gap, and I think that's the way we actually try to make the word of mouth going. So what we did was we do a lot of repostings on Instagram. So that's a fine-looking lady. That's a good-looking lady. This is a professor in Podomoro University. So that's unpleasant. He's trying to get healthy. So
He'll be good.
I've been coaching him a few times on exercises.
Nice.
So we just collaborated with 4 gyms in the PIC area, because I think somehow our database is mostly in PIC. I have no reason. I have no idea why. We've just collaborated with PIC. Wait. Elite PIC in PIC, and then we also have PIC Fit, and we also have 2 more gyms, which is Muay Thai and Yoga in PIC, and we're opening our 5th one in Kemang soon. So so far we have 3,000-ish followers, and the growth of our likes have been going down, but that's not the main point. Our key performance indicator for the company is not the likes, but actually the comments on the pictures. Because we want more engagement. We want the community to be involved in everything. So it's been growing up like crazy lately. The most comments that we have on one of our single pictures is 130, which is a lot for us. So I mean, to wrap up, like this business idea is not that complicated. It's just from passion and being real and being true. Like, you want to help people, you'll build the trust of people. And then when you build the trust, you build loyal customers and friends. I mean, you can see in our WhatsApp messages, they'll post, like, they'll send pictures of their sons, their husbands, and stuff. Like, one of the customers, the wife, she actually texted me, and like, because I pretend to be a girl sometimes, right?
Oh no!
You'll have to use all the language, like, hi sis, hi bro. You
know?
Anyway, so. She actually sent me like, hey, look at my fat husband. I'm like, okay. He's cute. I'm like, okay, that's fine. So, I mean, once you reach that point of your customer becoming your friend, they will actually trust in everything you say. So we're thinking of starting this not only as a juice company, but as a juice pioneer where everyone can just come to us and ask anything about health tips, about exercises. This is just a jumping stone for us. See? So the business may die, but the brand, trust, and relationship will always live on. So that's that.
I want to invite a big round of applause for our. Thank you very much, Ayu, Belta, and Alex, for your presentations, and they're very insightful. So let me just open a session, a short question and answer session. If you have any specific question related directly to their presentation, please do ask, and probably we will have 10 minutes of question and answer, and we will continue with a short break, and then we will continue with the second session. Any questions from the audience? Please, Eric, and then.
I'd like to ask Ayu and maybe Belfaya, if we're talking about social entrepreneurship, is there
guideline about how much profit we are allowed. Is it 10%, 20%, or 30%, something like that. And in terms of our financial book, we have to share it with our sponsors or something like, if we are claiming that we are doing something good with this enterprise, we have to prove it. And sometimes also to, may even be the public. So I would like to ask that question. How do you deal with that?
Thanks for the question, Eric. So it's basically about the profit, if there's a guideline or no. No, there's no guideline. Even the term social enterprise, it's now still loosely used, right? And it all depends on the values that the co-founders and the, I guess, the board have about that. So it can range anything from no profit at all, as long as it can still run, to, let's say, like Tom's, they have a buyout from Bain, right? So they're gaining a lot of profits from it. So it all depends on the decision that you will make with the team at first. So that's about profit. And then the second question,
financial book.
Okay. So financial book, you don't have any obligation to make it available for everybody in that sense, but if you have a mentorship, for example, if you have mentorship, they probably would want to know like our yearly like financial, at least for the length of the mentorship that they offer. And I guess we don't really show like financial books as for like a, but we can show our impacts, right? It's part of the marketing, it's part of the story to show the impact. So we would make it to some sort of yearly evaluation, like say like increase in income for the women like after a year working for us. That will be something that we actually want to share because that's part of our marketing strategy.
Thank you.
Yeah. I just want to add just one more point, or just iterating the last point, which is basically the investors, like impact investors or grant givers, they don't really care about how much profit you get, but what they really care is about impact. Right. So that's why in the financial book or whatever reporting that you have, if you are a social enterprise, it is very important that you have an impact evaluation mechanism. So just quantifying how much impact you get per dollar of their money, basically. So basically, so as long as you can be sustainable, they don't really care about profit as much as what a venture capitalist might be, for example. But they will be looking at that impact number, which can be very difficult sometimes because, you know, how do we measure impact and all that? That's a separate discussion. But basically, they want to see like how many lives saved, or how much additional income of per dollar that I give you. That's the most important.
This is for Ruang Guru.
Yes.
So, can you describe how is the behavior of the students? Like, what is the decision-making process when they decide to go with it? And what is the rate of returning customer?
Sure.
Because, you know, as an Indonesian, you know, as I figure out, I was like, why do I have to pay someone else? I could just talk with him. I like you. Let's just do it. Behind you.
So recurring revenue is a classic problem for marketplaces. So any marketplace that tries to connect somebody with someone else will always have this kind of problem, which is the recurring revenue problem. Because like the first transaction is always going to be through us, because any payment is through us, and then we'll take the cut and then we pay the teacher, right? But once they meet, then we don't know what they will do, right? They can have backdoor transaction and all that stuff, right? So basically how we tackle that is, so teachers are given rating, right? So basically rating is primarily based on the number of hours the teachers go with us. So basically there is a trade-off. So if they want to do the backdoor transaction, right, then they will get more money, they will not get cut, right? But they will not be able to build their profile on the website. So there is that trade-off. So basically, because we have like thousands of teachers, So if they do not have the profile, their rating is just like 1 or 2 or 3, then you will not get more students, right? So basically there is that trade-off. For customers, they actually have loyalty points too. The more they go through us, they will get more loyalty points, and they get free lessons and all that stuff too. And the other thing is we make it very explicit, both to teachers and students, that if you do backdoor transaction, then your accounts will be banned permanently. Right? So those are the two things. So basically making the incentives structure right for the teachers and students, and also making that threat, although we do not have any means to monitor or enforce anything. So and back to your question, the rate of recurring revenue is now at 70 to 75%, which is very, very good. I was only expecting like probably 30%, you know, because after all this maybe they will, but actually not, right? And we were very happy about it. So it's actually about 70 to 75%, and most of those who do not actually recur, they are already going somewhere else. You know, it's just like a one-time tool kind of preparation, and once they're done with it, they're done. So basically, it's very good. So we haven't seen that problem at all.
Yeah, are you planning to create an application, like mobile application, to connect between teachers and students, like in the future?
Sure. So we just finished developing APIs for the website. So API is basically so that people can get data through Rumble's database. And we are already developing the mobile application. And what's interesting, and this is, I don't know why, the one who is developing our mobile app is actually working for free. So basically, after we had all this, you know, like media attention, somebody actually emailed us and said that, I actually want to help you guys. I love the idea and I want to build my portfolio. I will build your mobile application for free. And you actually met him. He's like an experienced software engineer from Silicon Valley.
Wow.
So he's not doing it. And he, of course, he signed confidentiality agreement.
So my question is actually for everyone who has dealt with venture capital before and who has received seed funding. So basically, at what kind of stage that your business needs to be before you receive seed funding, and how long does it typically last for? And probably for someone that's currently looking for Series A funding, what would be your strategy for that? Especially in Indonesia, probably you can like talk about more about like the venture capital industry in Indonesia.
I only have experience with seed funding. I guess maybe Dalfa can talk about venture capital or Horlicks as well. But seed funding, again, it depends on the funders, but it ranges from you have zero thing, you just have the idea and you just submit a business plan basically, or even you just have to pitch your idea. And the amount of funding they give also range depending on the institution, right? And how long it lasts? Well, it depends, but for us it's probably gonna last for about like a year or so, like that's the plan from both of our funding. And yeah, I think that's what I can share from my experience.
I think Belfa can answer this, but I don't like the idea of having investors on my back, because sometimes when you have investors on your back, the founder's vision, they're pressured by the investors, so they actually divert from the original destination. So you make short-term decisions rather than long-term decisions. That's my point.
Okay, so the question was, at what stage of startup, right? So basically, I think it's different for different VC and different for different startup. I've seen people raising funding, a seed funding, with just the idea, right? They haven't really done anything, like any coding at all, or no recruitment, just the idea. So just made like a pitch deck and then, okay, this is what I want to do, so give me funding, right? And they actually succeeded. They actually got money, right? I've seen people also like Ruang Guru. So we already had the website, we already had customers, we already had like about 1,000 teachers at that point. So we already got some traction, right? And I know startups like Wizen, for example, the Ruang Guru of the US, they were already around for 10 years, they are already very sustainable. They actually do not need any more. So they can actually just, you know, put on to it. But they actually decided to get more funding in the end. So it's a different stages, different pieces. But it's possible, right? What's going to be different is the amount of money that you get, right? So if it's in the idea, you need to have very, very good credentials of why you are the person. Like, if I can give this funding, why you are the best person to execute on this idea. And also you need to be very aware that you probably will not get that much, right? So probably it's just like for a pilot, you know, like that person is just betting on you basically, that you actually has never seen it. So it's different. But basically it's possible because I've seen that happen. And then what's your next question?
So if venture capital in general in Indonesia, like who are the players, how big is it?
Okay. So there are different types of venture capitals. So the first one is those who are specialized in seed funding. Seed funding is basically like less than $1 million. So the examples are East Ventures is probably the most prominent. Some other Rebrite Capital, some angel funders. You can actually, if you look for it in tech in Asia, you can get. And then so that's seed funding, and there's Series A. Series A is after seed funding. So Series A is, I don't know, $1 million to $5 million maybe. And there are different types of venture capital. So like Mong Sills, venture capital. Well, IMJ, Venox, probably Rocket Internet too, and then Series B, Series C, and all that, right? So different. But normally they operate in Southeast Asia, so they don't just invest in Indonesia, they invest in Singapore, Thailand, and all that stuff too.
Okay, thank you. I'll open for two more questions if there are.
I have a question for Belva. So I'm not familiar with this industry. So how is your business model different than the US version?
It's basically about the same. Yeah. So it's not really. Well, probably we have the social impact component, and we focus more on the non-conventional parts because like Wizen is so much focused on test prep, but we actually do some. You know, like one interesting thing, ada anggota DPR, so she was just elected, right? And then she told us that she was not very confident about her public speaking, and she actually got a teacher from Ruang Guru, and her teacher was a radio announcer. So we actually focus more on these sides of two, jadi nggak cuma pelajaran, tapi you know like the other stuff. And we also do teacher driven, which is like the class gallery. So it's not just about private tutoring, but our main focus is basically like private tutoring.
Follow-up question, can I ask?
Yes.
So you mentioned that the US version is like sustainable right now, right?
Yes.
While you're still like a startup company, and I saw there are some cases where maybe in your case, if the teacher has already had very high ranking. Mm-hmm. And then they may like shut down from the Ruang Guru and then have like their own conventional places for like teach the students, right? How do you keep it like sustainable? I'm just like trying to like in the future.
So I guess your question is what if a teacher gets very prominent and then he
teaches himself?
Yeah,
it's like how do you say your business model becomes sustainable as
Yeah, so interestingly, some teachers, some very successful teachers actually tend to stay. And those who are not successful, tend to go away. I guess that's like the reality, I don't know why. Because probably like they actually have so much time and there's so many different subjects, right? Even though like probably they are popular in mathematics, for example, but they can also teach physics or whatever. And they can still get students from Ruang Guru. So basically, we haven't seen that yet. Probably we will, but I don't know.
Just one last question. Any other question?
No.
Okay. Yes.
So I think Indonesia is a very large country, and the market is like different: Jakarta, Kambaru, Medan, whatever it is. So I have a gut feeling that, at least for Belva and colleagues, that you guys are so more focused on the big city. So how do you do a market research for those not in the big city that doesn't fit your persona? And or is actually all your customers are mainly for big city right now?
And what do you mean by market research?
Sorry. Well, I mean, you have to figure out who is the type of people who is willing to buy your stuff. And I don't think you go to each place in Indonesia to figure that out, right?
Yeah. So what we're trying to do right now is basically target the health conscious people. Because for me, health is a luxurious item. It shouldn't be. But the way the business is going to grow is by people buying our product, right? And the people that's going to buy our product is the people that actually appreciates health. So people that's been overseas that comes back to Indo is mostly in the big cities. So I mean, the people in the big cities are still so, like, there's still so many of them. So I think for now we're just going to focus on the big cities. Yeah.
For me, I just want to start with, like, 80% of our business, or probably 90%, is in Jakarta, right? So we have a lot of teachers outside Jakarta, but the thing is, it's so much more difficult for them, probably because, like, online, and they're not that comfortable with, like, paying online and all this yet, right? Our customers are primarily based in Jakarta. But on market research, basically, it's actually not that different for us, because our customer acquisition model is we basically use social media a lot, but not in the page, but in ads. So we actually pay advertising to Facebook, right? I think we spend about $100 a day. So basically, the thing is, on Facebook, they can automatically test for you. So, and this is going to be a digital marketing class, but basically, so on Facebook, if you want to put an ad, right, you can put multiple different variations of the advertisement, right, with different, image, different text, different whatever, right, and they will auto-optimize for you which one works for that particular city. So what I found, for example, like in areas other than Jakarta, so we have this image of like a student with a teacher, both together, right? And the teacher was wearing jilbab, and that was popular in Jawa Tengah, Central Java, right? But not that popular in Jakarta, for some reason, right? But that is something that Facebook can automatically do for us. So they will auto-optimize for this city, you will get this to get the highest click-through rates, and then for this city you get this for the highest click-through rates and all that. So basically with technology, I think that is, like, the market research part can be kind of solved that way.
So I was asking this question because I was concerned about this kind of sort of online startup is sort of riding with the ride of the fact that people in big city just started to embrace this, where the US can't go past it already. So I'm just worried that, like, the growth in maybe 5 years more, where people are like, all right, it's not a big thing anymore, you know, and kind of stuck in the big city and not growing. That's why I'm asking. We have a lot of population, but in Jakarta, it's probably 30 minutes, I guess. Yes. Right. So.
Yeah. You want to respond to that, and then we close this question.
Okay. That's a valid concern. But I guess now the signs are good. Online penetration now in Indonesia is about 28%. It's primarily in big cities, but it's growing at 20% per year. And now the current Ministry of Infocom, I think, is better. and they actually by 2015 I think they have a target of 100 million people on the internet. So I guess it's also like how they are not very comfortable with internet and all that, because like
who you actually pay, right? And you haven't really met a person. It's not a physical person.
Right.
So, yeah, I mean, it's growing, and I think it's actually a very good time for us to be in the space, because, you know, once all these people start to get online and all that, and we have already established ourselves, and they can be our customers.
Right. Excellent. So I think it's a good time to have a break. There's some food over there. The restroom is over there for men and for women.
No, it's women's.
Also over there? Well, we'll find out. We'll have like a 15-minute break, and then we'll continue with more question and answer. Thank you very much. I like this spell.
I don't mind.
This is racist, by the way. It's racist, not mine. Okay, everyone, thank you for being on time on your recess. So we're entering our second session. We're going to have more questions and answers, and we have three great speakers here, three great young entrepreneurs. But before that, I want to have a very short announcement from the students, Indonesian students at Harvard. So we are happy to announce that we Indonesians in Harvard have formed our first official Indonesia club at Harvard University. What we'd like to do now is to give an opportunity for Eric as the president to introduce ourselves and themselves, including me. I'm included, so ourselves. And also to have some announcement. And then, please, Eric.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mas Pandi. Thank you, Ayu, Belva, Alex, for the great presentation. We learned a lot from you guys. Hi, guys. Hi, everybody. My name is Eric S. Darmanto. I am both the president and the client of the Indonesia Club at Harvard. Yes, it is. We are supposed to melayani, right? This is the first Indonesia club at Harvard, and our vision is we like to bring Harvard and Indonesia closer together. We hope that there will be many more Indonesians that are going to be studying in Harvard, and Harvard will know more about Indonesia. And our mission is we're going to create programs and events that will help educate and make us make this vision come true. For example, this Wednesday, we will be having Ibu Karen Agustiawan, the former CEO of Pertamina, and who's also Forbes number one Asia power businessman in the year 2011.
Businesswoman, sorry.
She will be addressing us on Wednesday in Harvard Kennedy, and we would like to invite all of you to come to join us. And also, we will have another program such as the family business and corporate citizenship. Because many of us are doing family business, and we like to discuss with you what can we do, what are the challenges in our family businesses, and what are the solutions. And also, having a family business also means that we can use our family business to improve the community, the society, and also our country. And we hope that you can join us with that also. And with that, I would like to introduce my colleagues here. Please, Harvard Indonesia Club, please stand up. Thank you. We have Mas Pandi dari SPLOs. Ayu is graduating, but you're forever with us.
You're so Ayu.
Belva is our project director. Day is our communication director. Sinta, our member, who's leading a division soon.
Yeah,
legal counsel.
Arbitrary decision.
Joe is our finance director. Utomo, our member at HBS, and our VP in PR and secretariat, Tatu. Please. And now, if I may give the opportunity to Sinta, maybe to share a bit about your programs. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, sure.
Okay, so guys, hi, my name is Shinta. I'm an LLM student from Harvard Law School. I want to ask first, how many are undergrads in here? No, undergrads. Okay, for the undergrads, how many of you think that you may want to continue your education to master studies? Cool. How many of you think that you may want to apply to Harvard? Okay. So actually, we start this organization. One of the reasons, and Eric may correct me if I'm wrong, that we want to support people who think they may want to apply to Harvard, and we would want to encourage people, especially Indonesian people, to join us in Harvard. Why? Because you know we are 250 million people. For example, in law school, I'm the only one out of 250 million people, and something is so wrong with that. Also from Harvard Business School and HKS, our numbers are so small compared to our whole population. So some of us have actually talked with the admission office, and they told us that one of the reasons is because out of everybody, Indonesia only have small numbers of people who actually apply to Harvard. And second, even though they apply to Harvard, they don't actually know how to answer all the essays or the questions. So they don't know how to. And this is how, like, I am going to be your bridge in connecting all of you with all of us, because we want to help you to be in Harvard if you want to. Or if you don't want to be in Harvard and you think you have a problem with writing your essays or selecting proper schools for you, we are going to help you. So as Eric said, we are your client. Yeah. So use us.
So, hi everyone, my name is Tomo. I'm currently a first year student at Harvard Business School. So one of the programs that we, I think Eric already alluded to, was the Family Business and Corporate Citizenship Conference that we will have. So I think a lot of us are in the family business, and I think we, as Indonesians, we do need an avenue that for all of us to come together and share and discuss some of the learnings. Where can we take our family businesses? Plus, there are some specific topics like succession planning, etc. I think a lot of us are interested in those kind of programs. And one of the things that we have the Indonesia Club at Harvard is going to plan is we will have a dinner planned for December 7th. Venue to be discussed, to be determined at a later period of time. But we want you guys to sign up for this dinner so that we can discuss and brainstorm on what we want for the conference. And this conference, I think, will be scheduled later in the spring semester. So once we get enough interest and once we have the relevant topics and the relevant speakers, we will announce like the full program later date. But for now, we have like a dinner at December 7th. So after this session, we would like to get your email so that we can brief you more about the program. That's about it. Actually, I'm not the one leading this initiative, but someone, one of my, I think Jeremiah is leading this initiative, but I'm presenting on his behalf. So,
yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, just in closing, by the way, my name is Tatum. I'm doing finance in Harvard as well. So just in closing, we're very excited to have you in our team, in our club, and we're also very excited, you know, to talk more to you about it. And if you know any other Indonesians who are in Harvard that you know, they don't know about us, please do tell them about us. So we'll be around, and you know the respective people to talk to about the things that we're going to have. If you're interested to join us for the dinner with Ibu Karen, please feel free to see me after this. If you want to join our club, see Shinta. If you want to do the family business and join our dinner, see Tomo. If you want to ask more about the club, ask Alec. All right, so thank you for your time, and enjoy the rest of the session.
Okay.
Thank you.
Please tell us if you want us to have like, some programs that you think we don't have.
Yep.
We are open to any like inputs.
Yes. We'd like you to join us. We do this together. Thank you.
Thank you for helping us
and supporting.
So one of the nice things that we have is Harvard Club, of Indonesian Harvard Club, is now we know we should be held accountable for the lack of attendance for Harvard students. Alright, so of course this is we are being helped greatly by the Association of Indonesian Students at MIT. So I'd like to direct you to that website if you want to know more seminar and events from the Association of Indonesian Students at Harvard, at MIT. Okay, so we will start with question and answers again. I hope you have more questions, and I'm sure our three panelists here are prepared to answer all your questions. But let me start with a general question. So this is recorded, and some of our videos are going to be online on YouTube. So So let me ask you a very general question. So how did you learn about running a business, starting up as an entrepreneur, and what do you think is the quality for someone to become a successful entrepreneur? So who would like to?
Ladies first, please.
Ayu.
Alright, that's a good question. So again, as Tomo just mentioned this now, but I first learned about running a business from my family because they also run their own business. And also throughout, I guess, throughout my education, I and experience working professionally after that, I kind of see how different institutions run their organizations. Like corporate is different from family business, for example. And the last thing is I also talk to a lot of people, and we talk about what kind of business they run and what's their role in their business, and this helped me a lot to learn about business. So one example is about social enterprise. We are now Duanyam. We stay in close contact with a lot of the social enterprise networks in Indonesia, and we were able to find like potential mentors, for example. There are Toraja Melo is one example of a social enterprise that's already up and running for about 10 years, and it has somewhat similar business model with us, but they just work in Toraja. So I learned a lot by talking to them, asking about the issues that they face, and also potential solutions, and learning from their experiences. In terms of like the technicals, like accountings and things like that, I think that would be something that you can learn as you go. You don't really have to have a formal education for it, as long as you have the dedication and commitment. So that's the most important part of being a successful entrepreneur. Dedication, commitment, and passion to what you are doing. That's the most important thing, because there will be a lot of problems when you start moving towards your goals. But as long as you have the time, the effort, and dedication, you can always try to problem solve it and try that solution and try to think of, if the solution doesn't work, try to think of other ways to solve it.
Thank you, Ais. Belva or Horace?
So same with Ayu. I've been brought up in a family business. From 12 years old, I've been forced to sit in a meeting where I don't even know what they're talking about.
Wow.
I'm like, okay. So since then on, I mean, I found my passion, as I described before, in health and the fitness industry. But then, like, I think the way I want to run the company is an open culture, like open innovation. So it's not a very, it's not like authoritative style of doing the company. So we have 3 new staffs last month. But then before that, before I leave to Babson, the way I try to do this to the company is like, it's more like teaching. So when I actually delegate my tasks to them, I actually just ask them, you know what, this is the way we are trying to run the company, right? So social media, this handphone will be more important than your personal phone. So this handphone is gonna be yours. So she is the one that's replying to the customers. and she is the one asking me whether it's correct or not. So I'm not the one who's saying like, you should do this, you should do this. Instead, I'm gonna ask her to actually do it, and I'll see whether she did anything wrong, and then I'll try to correct it. So that's the way we're trying to run it. I mean, at the end of the day, a firm's greatest asset is the human. So because I see this in many family business, especially the older generations, they're very dictated. So what it does to the company is, especially in this new modern age, where the market is always changing, and the humans inside are not able to cope with the new demand. You need the staff to be actually engaged to the customers, right? So you need them to actually interact with the customers as much as possible. And you need to create that culture of just, you know, keep improving themselves. That's the main thing.
Yeah. So for me, like, my family doesn't own any business, so I didn't have that experience. But I did, my undergrad was in business. So I learned about marketing, accounting, and all that basic stuff from there. And I'm also doing my MBA currently, and I work at McKinsey. That experience is really helpful for me, because that actually forces me to think in a way that is structured, right? In a way that's comprehensive, and I think that really helped, right? But I guess at the end of the day, there is no single training that can prepare you to be a businessman or businesswoman. Because it's basically just learning on the fly, you know? And basically, if you have an idea, right? There is really no perfect timing. Like, I will wait for this, I will wait for that, I will wait for whatever, right? Just start, right? And then learn on the job, right? And the way you learn is through seeing other people's mistakes, and other people's success, right? And through talking to your customers. So basically, I just want to iterate that point, because that is really, really important. You cannot assume that you know everything. Even if you are here, you know, you have good education, but basically what your customers want, you do not know at all, right? So basically the way to do it is to reiterate and test and test and test. So do not have like a specific idea in mind. Okay, I have this idea. I want to execute this perfectly, right? 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, and then I launch and nobody uses it, right? So basically you do it like, okay, this is like the minimum viable product. So this is like, you know, just a test case, and then let other people see it, get feedback, and iterate along the way. And that is a process that never stops, right? So basically, there's really no single training. You just need to just be there, plunge yourself into the world, and then iterate. Know that you will fail at some point, and you will fail often too. But I guess there's really no training. You just have to do it.
Thank you. Those are great insights. So I hope that really can serve as an introduction to our question and answer session. So, I just want to ask you if you could mention, like, say your name. I don't want to pretend that I know everyone here. So before you end, to whom you're directing your question, and then say your question. Okay.
Question. Hi all, my name is Shinta. I'm from Harvard Law School. I have a question for everybody. First for Horlicks, and second for, this is for IU and Bill. For Horlicks, my question is, I know cold press, and then I think a lot of my friends consume cold press, so congratulations for the business. And then what I want to ask is, right now you acknowledge that there are a lot of cold press juices companies. How are you going to differentiate yourself from the market? And what is your plan in the future to sustain your business? And second of all, for IU and Belfa, you are now doing social entrepreneurship. And then my question will be, like, at the first time you want to fund your company, out of tons of organizations and SIP grants company, you have to pick, right? How to pick? How to best select the organizations that would actually strengthen your business instead of, like Horlicks said, clash your business. How to do it? And second, how to assure venture capitals, especially in your case, because it's not seed grants, and we know what venture capitals do to small business. How are you going to make sure that your business is going to sustain amidst all of their pressure?
I think that's a lot of questions.
Okay.
Those questions answered, and then before we move on to the next question.
Sorry, guys.
I wasn't saying there's too much question. There's a lot of questions. Anyway, so, Hanik, who is Tanya? Yeah.
Good question, though, differentiator. The thing is this, I mean, at the end of the day, you gotta realize your the business nature, right? At the end of the day, it's a juice. There's nothing technical, it's everyone can make it. It's not something that, like, well, but he's a genius, so he can make stuff up. I cannot. I'm a very non-technical person, I do what I can. So there's no differentiator between other competitors, except the fact that it's a real and true product, and which goes back to the point where the vision of the company is I won't sell what I won't drink. So, and that will translate to all the customers. So, I mean, we at the moment we're trying to grow it organically. We're not trying to, for the sake of commercialization, we're not trying to trade that real perception. So that's really my main goal. In terms of like future plans, for now, I think we want to go into like the lifestyle section. So it's like it's really hard for people to get healthy nowadays in Indo. Like, and everything you do, let's say a cinema, right? So we're currently trying to get into XXE. We're trying to talk to the owner. So, like, in everything you do, you can actually be healthy. So let's say you want to buy a popcorn, but there's cold press. So at least there's something healthy. So it actually triggers the, you know, moment, like, for people to be healthy. So, I mean, that's the future.
So your question was how to select, right? So I guess like his point earlier that, you know, they can divert you from your original idea and all that initiative. That is true, but that is true only for some pieces, some venture capitals, right? So different venture capitals are different, right? And the way that you basically need to test whether that is the piece that I want to work with is you basically talk to their current portfolio, which I did. So basically, my friend was already funded by East Ventures, and I basically asked him, right? Dia cerewet, yeah. Dia ngapain? You know, like this kind of questions, because that is very important. Because I don't wanna, because I have so many things to do, so much stuff to think about. I don't wanna be thinking about things that I don't wanna be thinking about. So, and he was like, no, he's chill. So basically. It's just like one monthly report, and monthly report like template is up to you, and then he's just basically trying to be helpful. Like if you wanna be introduced to media and all that stuff, that he will be helpful, but he will not impose anything on you, right? So basically, that is a very good task that you have to do before getting any funding, because as you said, and it's true, some PCs actually impose their idea on entrepreneurs, which basically will mean that your original idea will be killed. So that's one. And second, how you test is, in addition to money, what can they provide you with, right? Because money, everybody has money, but what can they provide you with in addition to money? So in this case, East Ventures is basically the most prominent, basically PC, seed funded in Southeast Asia, I think. So we got the branding. Right, because almost all of their portfolio companies at some point will get big, like Traveloka, you know, Tokopedia, you know, and all that. So they know actually how to transform or how the journey is like, right? From the moment where it's just a small startup to the point where you are actually a big startup or a big company, right? So they have done that, right? And we haven't done that as entrepreneurs, so we basically want to have that source of knowledge from him, basically, because he knew, like, okay, in 1 year you need to raise funding for Series A, and he will help us do that. And after that, Series B, what are VCs actually looking for? All these things we actually do not know, and we need to know from him, right? And he is one of the very few seed funding VCs who actually have done this before, so that's what we wanted to get, right? So yeah, and about incentive, like actually venture capitals have the same incentives as us, right? They want us to be big, right? Because they will not get any money if we do not get big, basically they're betting on us. So basically they want the Series A funding in our valuation to be as big as possible, right? Which is also in our interest. So basically there's really no, you know, conflict of interest other than probably they have like a separate idea, right? But that you can pass aside, as I mentioned before, in the first one. So
So since Belfa has explained about venture capital very nicely, I will talk more about like the grant base where there is no sort of you have to pay back or they have a say in your company really because they only give you that grant and perhaps they offer their mentorship, but it's mostly you don't have to give back anything other than show that you actually work on your projects, right? So there's a couple things, I guess. So the first one is as early sex. Set, what comes other than the money, right? For example, for us, the MIT Ideas Google Challenge, it comes with the resources, the contacts, the connections that they can provide us to help us advance our social enterprise. And it also comes with credibility. So it means that the next time we're trying to apply for other grant fundings, they will see that, oh, you guys already won the MIT, so that means MIT thinks you guys are, the ideas are good enough and you are capable people to do it, so other venues would less hesitant to give you their grant. So the second point is what Paulik said about, I guess we call it the mission group, and actually we have this kind of issues, not really issues, but experience with mission group. So for example, there are institutions that would give grant seed funding for social enterprise or any sort of institution that would help increase nutrition for children under 5, for example. And then we're thinking, we can tap into this. We can work with the increased income that the women have to allocate that to buying more nutritious food for the children, right? So that is a very good idea. We can really work on it. But is that the best thing for us right now? When our operation is not as smooth, like should we like try to also achieve that at the same time just because we want to win the grant? Like that's when you want to see whether it's the right type of grant for you to apply or not. And maybe it will be in like 2 years after everything runs smoothly, then you can tap into that, but maybe not now.
So let me step take one step back. How did you know that your idea was great? How did you know that, oh, this is a good idea and I should run this into a business? And this is a question for everyone. How did you know? Anyone can start. Yeah.
Well, I can start. First, this model is not new. So this model has worked elsewhere, right? So that is like the first thing that we had. So basically there is a similar model in the US, it's been successful with millions of hours registered and all that, so there must be a business model there, right? So that's one. And the second thing is just like personal stories, like my little sister, so she wanted to basically like take this WebMetaN, which is crazy, and she was like, oh, but I need like a physics tutor, but she really didn't know where to go. So basically what she did was, and my mom basically, like calling random like friends, asking, do you have recommendation for six to her? Do you have recommendation for this? Do you have recommendation for that? And then, well, we got names and we hired one, and then, but it's average quality. We didn't know where he came from and all that. So, and we felt that, and my father and I felt that, my co-founder and I, felt that this should change, right? It should be a database of like, you know, like the good teachers in the country, right? We know the background, and they're properly rated by their previous students and all that, right? So we thought that, we haven't had this, we already had this problem for so long in Indonesia, nobody's working on it, so we had to do it. So that's this case.
How I know is whether this idea is going to be great. Actually, I have no idea that it's going to be great. But all I know is I like the business ideas that is low in capital intensity. And if I do fail, I can just fail and go out. It's that. I mean, for me, that's my personal opinion. So for me, the capital investment in this business is very small to start up. So I don't think too much whether it's going to be a great idea, but I know the fact that the gym numbers, the number of gyms in Jakarta has increased almost 450% in the last 4 years. And every gym that's been opening in every single mall will always be full. So especially in the Moy area, the Moy area is in Papagani. Thank you. So that gym has at least 12,000 members. So we're just trying to capsize the healthy population, and we came up with a very good number, estimation of our 5-year projection. So that's pretty much how I try to capsize.
Okay. So I guess my idea is it's slightly different than Delphi and Felix, because there are examples of how the ideas work in other business, I guess. My idea is kind of like come out of thin air. It's an innovation, right? And the key thing for me was to keep on talking about the idea over and over and over again to everybody I met, to anyone, like friends, to like professors, to families, right? And to refine the idea as you go, when you listen to the inputs, the comments from other people. So we didn't directly come up with this whole weaving farming cooperative idea. We were just thinking about telling the pregnant women to weave. But then like people start asking that, what happened with their field? What happened if like nobody's working in the field? Like, would this be okay for the economy, blah, blah. So we have to like think again, like, oh, so how do we make sure that even though they're weaving, their farm are still tended, right? So that's how we come up with the idea. Other example, we didn't know that we want to pursue corporate customer, because so far a lot of artisanal business, they only go for the individual customer with high profit margin, right? But I was talking with Day as well, and he was with asking about, oh, that's a very kind of like trendy thing. Maybe like they like this design for a while, then they stop buying it, then like what happened with sustainability? So we are forced to think outside the box and think, oh, maybe with corporate customers, they will have repeated orders. For example, hotel sleepers, they will always have that kind of orders, and we can secure it, and we don't have to spend too much marketing effort to it. We get high volume, for example. So it's a lot of sharing your idea, being proud of it, having ownership of it, and listening to other inputs and refining it.
Thank you. Any questions from the audience?
Hi, I'm Liz. I'm from Permias. My question is for Lix. Can your business is surrounding the health and organic stuff and healthy living? As your business becomes bigger, how do you control like the quality of your juices, especially if you only have like 3 days of shelf life for your juices? And with like all the growing demands, if you have stock, like how do you deal with that? Do you care at all about like 100% about the quality of your juices, or would you, as it becomes bigger and you have like more stores, more customers, how do you do like quality control?
So address the.
All right. And my question is to Belfa. You mentioned about you choosing the venture capitalist. How many options of venture capitalists did you have, and how did you actually get so many venture capitalists to be voting for you?
Thank you.
To address your question about the inventory stock control, so what we did was we tried to implement the inventory, like the demand. We tried to forecast the demand, and we actually incorporate that into our margins. So we have a one day where we try to predict the loss, and it's actually incorporated into like 15% of our buffer margin. So that's how we do it. So we wouldn't compromise our quality at all. We would still, if it's over than 3 days, we'll actually pull it back and we'll just throw it away. So like as an example of one of our customers, actually a few. They actually purchased the product. Let's say you're doing your detox today. You say you want to do it today, so we delivered it yesterday, right? So, but then today you suddenly have a meeting outside. And then they told us, like, is it fine to drink it starting tomorrow? So we told them, like, no, it's not good. So just give us back the product, and we'll just send you a new one for free. So it's part of our, our care to the customer. So I guess that's how the cycle begins.
Yeah. So PCs. We actually talk about it to two PCs, not too many. Basically the most effective way of getting noticed by PC is to be introduced by someone. So you do not cold email people. You need to be introduced by someone in their circle, right? So I was fortunate enough that some of my friends, they actually got startups who got funded, and through some Kinsey connection too, and we got introduced to these PCs, right? And basically, it is a very easy process, surprisingly, right? Because once you got introduced, and this doesn't apply if you cold email. If you were introduced by someone, so my friend introduced me, like for example now, around late afternoon-ish, and then he replied back in the evening saying that, okay, let's meet tomorrow morning in my office. And then so my co-founder and I was like, oh my god, we don't have a pitch deck, so we basically like okay, made that presentation, and we met him in his office in the morning. And it was just like a 30 minutes discussion, and he was, oh, okay, I'm in. And then that's it. And then after that, it's just a matter of negotiating the amount of money and the pressure pitch. So basically, the main thing is to get introduced and not to cold email. Well, some of my friends actually cold emailed and they succeeded. But the best way is to get introduced.
Any other questions? Latum and Wawan.
Hi. So my first question, do you guys take salaries from your ventures? And secondly, I know that you have an exit strategy. What about you guys? Do you guys think about some exit strategies already?
Thank you. My question is for everyone. So I believe that in running your business, guys, you face some challenge or problems. So I was wondering, what were the challenges that you had, and how did you guys manage to overcome all those things? And my second question is for Mr. Belfa.
So I was wondering about the system between the teacher and the students at Rangger.com. So would there be any like agreement? So for example, like if the teacher is not like they expect it to be, for example, like
yeah,
teachers
yeah.
like, you know, boring, something like that. So is it possible for students to change the teacher?
Yes.
And what are the responsibilities of the teachers? Do they have to make a report monthly or weekly or whatever? Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Who would like to answer the first question? Salary.
Should we answer all three questions
sure,
before
sure,
moving or
sure,
should we tackle
sure.
it?
So you
questions?
Can. You can.
Okay. Alright, so the first question is about salary. So right now we do not have salary yet because we're still in the starting point, but we do envision that there will be appropriate salary firstly for our field facilitator, our staff on the ground, that will be for sure, and then for the board of directors if our profit allows us to do that. And you know, we envision that in the long run, if we are really successful, that the board of directors will be filled by professionals, so that the shareholders will be able to move on to something else. For example, for me, maybe serial entrepreneur starting another social enterprise, right? So that's why the salary is important to start. I have a friend who is running a social enterprise too. He starts with a zero salary, and the co-founder gets like $100 per month salary. And then after 3 years, he gets $100 salary, and the co-founder gets $400 per month salary. So like it moves slowly in the social enterprise area, but it is certainly you can achieve, right? So for the exit strategy, I was mentioning one exit strategy. If we are very successful, then we would definitely keep on growing, because that's what we want. We want to maximize our impact, so we want to expand our reach. Maybe let's say in like 3-5 years we will have covered most of NTT, for example, the village there where there's really need for
these models work. And then maybe after that, if we still have the profit that allows us to grow, we will expand to another province. And we will, of course, adapt to the existing skills that they have. Maybe like it's not going to be weaving, it will be something else. We will have to adapt to that and try to create a market for that as well. That would be our added value. And if, for example, we are profitable but not to the point that we can grow and expand our business continuously, then another exit strategy that we're thinking about, that we will invest in the community of women. So we will train them, we will invest in them so that they can start running the business, so that they will know how to do like all the financial stuff, and we will give the context of some of the potential customers. We will teach them how to use social media and everything, and basically trying to shift the responsibility from us to them so that we can focus on, let's say, just the marketing part. And they would take over the production at first, and maybe if the empowerment program works as well, so we can shift the step that I was mentioning before. So yeah, that's some of the exit strategy I was thinking about. And we could also again collaborate with the government, right? So the government can help, comes in, so like maybe the Department of Health and the Department of small enterprises can help and take over some of our responsibility. That's a possibility in the long run. So there are, depending on the scenarios, that's going to happen. So the last question is challenges. Okay. All right. So there's three major challenges. I don't know if that's too much. But the first one is about the team management, because we have quite a big team, I guess. Like there are like 7 shareholders, and we have a team in the MIT as well, the student groups. So there's a lot of management, and there's a lot of organizing for us to try to meet weekly, for example, or like every 2 weekly for the other parts of the team, right? And everybody's in different part of the world, so we have to take that into account. But it can also actually be an opportunity, as long as the communication is good, and as long as role is defined well, because people can work in like 24-hour cycle in the US and then in Indonesia. And people in the US have access to information about US market, people in Australia have access about Australian market, and so on. So I guess the communication is how we get over that. And second thing is infrastructure, which is for us is shipping, because there's very few options right now for shipping in NTT, so the price is still super expensive. That's like the major cost outside for the salary that we give to the weavers. And it's still a continuous challenge for us. We found some like informal solution to it, like we can give like a tip of let's say $2 to the angkot driver to bring this big bag of items that they don't weigh how much that is to the airport or something like that. But the core problem is still that there's not much options there yet, and hoping that the government, like Tol Laut by Jokowi, would help this issue, for example. We'll wait to see that, or like development of tourism will maybe help this issue as well. The last one, sorry, this is very long, but the last challenge we have is working with the communities, right? With people that have different perceptions and have different cultures. It's sometimes hard. For example, we have a deadline to give this order by like a month or something, and then there's marriage happening, and then there's deaths in the village. So they all, like if there's a marriage, there's no catering or anything, so everybody in the village has to cook for like 2 days, 3 days, right? So like nobody's working, and once they're done with it, they would just, you know, tend to their farm first before leaving. So like that's a setback that we have to take into account when we're trying to make deals with our corporate customer. We have to tell them that this is the case, like the deadline cannot be like set, this is the date, maybe like or like one plus 1 month or so, you know, in case.
Did they get warning if they late for submitting all this crafting?
We No, they don't, because you can't do anything if like their family's dead or something, or like someone's
leaving. Not about the death.
Right. No, but it's something is already there. It's in their culture. It will be like so much effort trying to change that like money and work is more important than your cousins getting married. Like that would be something we probably don't have. But another solution that we're thinking about is, because right now we're piloting in one village, right? But once we have a lot of village, we can kind of like diversify the risk. So if one village have a marriage, then the other village might not have it. So we can still address the production issues, right?
So hopefully marriage doesn't come in seasons.
Doesn't come in all villages.
So Hornis, probably you want to respond to Captain's question and Rowan's question before.
I'll keep it short and compact. So salaries? No salaries. We don't intend to actually take any salaries until we haven't even thought of taking salaries out of the company.
Why not?
It's still growing. So every time we're gonna take money out, it's just gonna be going in again. So there's no point taking it out, honestly. And I mean the exit strategy for now. There's no exit strategy but to keep growing, because we're thinking of actually making other health products, especially from our byproducts. You know how if you cold press something, there's, let's say, the almond rempah-rempah, or the ampas. So we're thinking of making that into a protein bar, or let's say into other stuff. I mean, you can use it on its own. And it has a lot of nutrients inside it, so might as well use it. So challenges, I'll break it up into two. First is personal. Second is through the business side of things. So the personal one is basically, if you guys are all in family businesses, your parents would want a stake in this business for sure. They will control you, they will choke your neck from the back, they'll try to do everything to get control of your, you know, as a son or as a daughter. So that's the first personal problem. Maybe you've experienced it, but so we actually, we find a good timing in last December. In not New York, in LA, we're sitting down and then we're having all, it's a good day, Sunday, and then we talk like, Mom, we need to get this straight. So what's the control or the authority that you're trying to establish here? Even though you've got majority of the stake, that's just 60%, but we got to have the operation. So don't come back to us about branding, about stuff, because it's our company, we want to run it. You can be the advisor, but please don't have the finance thing. So you gotta make that clear with your parents. I mean, if anyone is gonna start something. So that's the personal one. I mean, the second one, because this is a new product, the hardest thing to do is actually educating the customers. One of my good friend Yumi, he actually made the bottle O2, H2O water, and he told me that the company has been trying to educate the market for at least like 5 to 7 years. Or an oxygenated water, right? So I don't know how long this is gonna take, but I think that's the hardest thing for me to do right now, to educate the customers that this thing is actually healthier than the juice that we actually drink on an everyday basis.
Salaries.
Salary, exit plan, challenges, and the specific questions about features.
Okay. So salaries, we all get salaries. Except me. Because I'm not full time, so all full time employees, including my co-founder now is the CEO. He takes salaries every month. Competitive, is better than his alternative. And all of the employees take salaries, and it's actually quite complicated with like KPIs for performance, and bonuses. All that is set up for all employees, because we think that talent is very, very important. And it's very important to help to motivate them. Right? So basically, every single one of our employees is salary competitive. And whatever challenge.
Next plan.
Yeah. Okay. So the number one challenge is hiring for me, because it's very difficult to get good people in Indonesia. Especially technical talent. So our web developer now, the most senior, he actually like he jumped from startup to startup, right? Senior. But he's still not well, you know, I don't know. There's a lot of, like, it's not to the level that he wants to get, right? And for example, digital marketing, like, you know, buying these ads from Facebook, Google, it's actually very, very complicated. Like, you need to set targeting, optimize, you remarket. So, you know, like, if you go to website, like, if you go to, I don't know, like, Ruang Guru website, right? And then you go to your Facebook, and then you find Ruang Guru ads on Facebook, right? All this stuff, you know, we actually have done that. But there's actually a lot more complication in there, you know, in bidding for keywords and AdWords and all that. And we don't have that talent yet. So basically, I am the one who's doing it. So hiring is a big, big problem. And the second challenge is probably the lack of competitor. And you might wonder why this is a challenge. It's because of the educating the market. We have a competitor. There is someone else who is also educating the market. So we don't spend so much time, you know, like this, you can actually just pay online and all that. You know, like all these parents still call us. So even though they can do the transactions, all these parents still call us like, this is right, you know, all this stuff, right? There is a competitor, and you know, we can focus on what makes us different and all that, and not, you know, preparing the market. So yeah, so I think those are the two challenges. And the specific question, yes, we do offer 100% guarantee money refund. So
did you ever have that case?
We did once. So the way it works is the first lesson, you don't like it, we will change for maximum 2 times, and after 2 times, if you're still not satisfied, then you refund. But we like but there's 99%.
How did the teacher feel about that? The teacher.
Well, usually it's when the teacher is not professional, so they're late or they are whatever. Right? But
what about his payment then? If he suddenly get rejected in the middle of his doing it.
So the first lesson, if the student is not satisfied, he will not pay. So the first lesson is like that. Trial, but if the student is satisfied, then he will get it.
What about if the student gets bored at the third meeting, for example?
Bored at the third meeting?
Yeah, and then he wants to.
Then we will not refund. Yeah, because it's complicated, but yeah, we have like a whole SOP on that.
So we're running out of time, but so I will open for one more round of questions. Do you have any questions? Casey.
I'm Lucy from the guest. I want to ask to everyone, how did you find the right people for your company, starting from the co-founder, and what's your company culture like?
Last question.
What's the company culture?
Who'd like to start?
Alex,
how did you pick your sister? Good point. How do I pick my sister? With hiring people, right? It's a very like intangible thing, like you can feel it, but it's I know it's not a very good answer, but I like interacting with people, and I think the moment you talk with someone, I think you know whether they can click the company's culture, you know whether they think fast, and the main thing we want in our company is the people asking why, not people that just says ABS, apa bapak senang. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is a big no-no. It's like, but so we actually have two staff that actually came in and we tried to interview them, and then whatever we say, she is smart. Okay, she's a S1 graduate. But whatever we say, she just write things down, and she never questions anything. So the thing is, we want to create the company's culture where it always continues, it always improves. So you gotta keep always asking why. And in a meeting is always constructive when people reject your idea. That's when a constructive debate is actually happening. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
What's the question? The co-founder. Oh, okay. Co-founder is complementary skill, basically, and network. My co-founder, he was the president of the probably the biggest youth organization in Indonesia. So like the first few hundreds of our teachers actually came from his organization. His organization is in Jakarta, it's in Lampung, it's in Indonesia, it's six cities in Indonesia. So so that is good, right? And then he also got background in education, which I don't have. So basically, it's complementary skills. So I bring the business skills, the idea, and all that stuff. And he brings the network and the education background, basically. And of course, you need to trust him or her with your business, right? Because so you need to know him or her for long, and you have good friendship and all that before actually be a partner in business. And then on company culture, so it's I guess it's fun, it's open. That's why we decorated the office, if you remember, right? So we wanted to also the culture to be visible to people who visit and all that, right? So there are a lot of drawings on the wall. There's a lot of like this toys, I don't know. And then it's very flexible, it's open environment. Even one employee actually told me that if there is no ruang guru, then she will not work. because it's such a fun environment, it's all like young people, like they go in office like 9 to 5, but it's like you can wear all you want. It's like there's pizza day every month, and we go outing and all that stuff. So it's fun and it's the profession.
Same with Delpha, I think the important thing is you know that person well. So in this case, there's a couple of my friends basically are co-founders, and not just pick randomly, but depending on the skills and experience that they have. So I guess the three core co-founders would be me, and then one person who works in NTT right now is an NGO, so she really has good networks with the community and the local governments already, so that's really important for our social side. And the other person, she also works in her family business in real estate, and she has really good marketing skills, and she's very, I don't know, like positive, she can sell anything to anyone, so she's handling our marketing part. So those are the three core co-founders, and we have other co-founders that they have a slightly different shares than the core ones, and they are, one is also our legal counsel, and one is our IT experts, and the other one is our finance experts, and ex-consultant, or still, but yeah. Okay. So for the corporate culture, I think because of the relationship that we have, it's a lot of openness, so you just say whatever you think. You don't have to cover things up or try to cover whatever your motives behind your decision. And we can be tolerant to if there's like personal or your full-time job issues, then we can take that into accommodation as long as you're still professional and get the job done. And also entrepreneurial, everyone can be innovative and have initiative on their own. For example, like my co-founder who's in NTT suddenly get asked an order from Transcorp or somewhere, even though it's not her job, but like she just likes to talk about us a lot, that she finally gets through connection some potential customer for us.
Okay, so this has been a great discussion, and unfortunately we have to end now, but let me close with a couple of questions. I'm taking my authority as a moderator here. But just in closing, to my understanding, Indonesia is recognized as one of the most difficult place to start a business. So what has your experience been with the regulations? And I think in general the question is, how actually you start out a business in Indonesia? How did you start your business in Indonesia? And you can comment, correct me if I'm wrong, but yes, please. And then I think we can close with, do you have any tips for the audience and all audience that will see this? Or else you can start with.
I would start a healthy debate with you.
Of course, please.
I wouldn't say Indonesia is a hard place to start a business.
Okay.
Especially to the fact that you said the regulations. I personally would say regulations is very lenient in my perspective, especially DEPKES and PRIT. Although I'm not saying I'm breaking the rules of healthy stuff. But I mean, the rules are still not there yet. Like, especially organic stuff. Even in US, organic stuff, to put a label organic USDA, there's three requirements you need. But then there's ways around it, ways around you can get that stamp. Okay. So if you fulfill two, you can get it, the organic USDA. And in Indo right now, there's the organic association already, but then it's still very shady for me. So I mean, that's why I'm coming back to the point, in my industry, I don't think it's hard to start a business in the health and fitness industry. So what's the second?
Do you have any tips?
Oh, tips.
Yeah. In general, just not.
In general, I guess, for me, the biggest thing is passion. Like, I keep saying it over and over again, like, it might sound very cliche and bassy, but for me, the passion and the joy I get is the thing that keeps me forward, and that's about it.
So for me, regulation, it's been actually quite tough and time consuming, especially in setting up my own mini PT. And then you need to take care of CEO,
mm-hmm.
and then you need to take care of C2, I don't know about that.
and then
it's a lawyer.
Yeah.
Correct me if I'm wrong. There's trademark and all this, and it all takes so long. Terus kayak we just got funding, so we did some changes in the board of commissioners. So to change that name, it also took so long. So I guess it's like the pace of it doesn't really affect us as a business because we actually still do our operations, but it's still at the back of our minds that okay, this is not yet done. This is like already what, 2 months and all that, right? So there's that. And there's also like this regulation about e-commerce. Now I'm not an e-commerce, so that's good. So basically, e-commerce, it's actually in a negative list. So you cannot get outside funding from outside Indonesia to buy BKPM, like for some reason. So that has been very, very stressful actually for, because like without funding, you cannot really grow, right? And if you're competing with other like marketplaces outside, it's just not possible. So that's it. So there's some, you know, random regulation and it takes so long. On general tips. So basically, I think that you know, starting a business actually now is not that risky, unlike so many years ago, right? Because one, especially in Indonesia. Because one, there's a lot of VCs, but not a lot of entrepreneurs. And that is actually why I think, you know, it was very easy, because he saw probably our credentials, like this is a solid plan, it's a workable idea. Fund it, right? And there's a lot of VCs, like we are meeting VCs like so many times. So like tomorrow on Monday, we're meeting one other VC, right? Because they actually also have targets on like, how much money they should spend this year and all that, right? And there's not many good entrepreneurs around, right? And the thing is, because now you have, when you have funding, the thing is you can get salaries, right? So it's not like a few years ago when you actually build a business and you don't take salaries for so many months, and then suddenly it goes bust and then that's it, you don't have any saving and all that, right? But then you can actually take salaries, right? Even if it goes bust, you actually got salaries, right? So, and you got shares, right? Probably your salary is not as high as what you would get from working for a company, right? Or for an international company or what, but it's enough. And you get your share, and you get to do, and you get to pursue pursue your passion, right? So I think this is like a very, very rare time, I guess, in Indonesia. Like it's a very rare time, it's a very like prime time to do a business because it's not risky at all. And there's a lot of potential. So,
are you?
So with regulation, we actually at one point we try to see how if we want to make the, if we want to incorporate in the US, right? And I guess this is where Maspanji is coming from, that it's hard to start a business in the in Indonesia in that sense, because to make a PT in Indonesia you need like 1,500 just for like all the fees, I think, with the notary and all that, and then you also need some like at least initial capital, like I don't know, like 50 million rupiah to 100 million rupiah or something like that. So it's really hard versus in the US you can start with $500, zero initial capital, right? So I guess that's the differentiation. And when we work with the MIT students, they're like, they don't really get why we need like 1500 for notary plus fee plus blah blah blah. But we end up, we're very fortunate to get a pro bono notary, so we didn't really have to spend that much, just really the legal fees that we need to pay for the government. And the other thing about regulation, I think it's not, even in the US and other developed countries for social enterprise, it's not really that friendly yet. I think they start to be in the US. But certainly not Indonesia. So things like if I get like grant funding, like a grant seed funding, right? In a sense, it's seen as a donation, so we can't really just directly put that in the in like the financial books, and we cannot really ask people to donate. Although a lot of people ask, how much do you need? Like, we want to donate. CSR wants to donate, but it will be hard for us because as a PT, we cannot really. Receive it just like that. For example, the grant has to be personal, kind of like it has to be go through individual first before I can invest it, kind of like put it in the capital for the PT. That's an illustration. And the other thing is also when we want to work with the government or with the community, it's a little bit harder if we come in as a PT for a social enterprise. The government. Maybe with Ministry of Trade and Industry, it's not a problem. But with Ministry of Health, it might be a problem. It'll be like, what is behind like this? They're thinking about pharma and all sorts. And like, so we see a necessity for us, and we saw this with other social enterprise to make another incorporate to another body, either a foundation or cooperatives. In that case, that means our women member will be member of our cooperatives, right? So we can. Deliver the social goods through the foundation or the cooperative arms while we get the business in from the PT. This is not uncommon for many social enterprises in Indonesia. So that's what the regulation entails, I guess, for now. And so for tips, I think, again, what's important is dedication and passion. And if you don't know your passion yet, by like talking to a lot of people and like, you know, like taking in more information, you'll start to learn what makes you excited, I guess, and you will know what your passion is. And it doesn't really matter if you don't have the experience or skills yet, or if you don't have a lot of money at hand to start, because as Belfa said, right now there are so many investors and funders that actually want to invest in Indonesia, like specifically, because we are the fourth largest country, we are still growing, and so. There's a lot of opportunity for that. So once you find your passion, then just go for it, I guess.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Holix, Belfa, and Ayu.
Yes.
As a moderator, I'd like to summarize the discussion, but I think I can.
Yeah.
Rich discussion and a lot of insights. And again, I would like to thank you all and all for coming. And again, let's give a big round of applause to